that is and tells me this is an Ilex aquifoliaceae. So suddenly, the whole of the physical world becomes a way of accessing our knowledge about that world. This is not working yet, but you can see that this is happening. I've developed this in an article for the, or a keynote in Ancona for UNESCO on the new book of nature. I developed that again in Brasilia. So the name of this universal library has been various: Library of Alexandria, Total Library, Library of Babel, Universal Library. And in the last 100 years, we've been using words like world brain and world mind. Of course, Alexandria, we know. Then there have been visionary notions of what this should look like. Here's Borges' idea of the late Library of Babel in various versions. There, this is the new Library of Alexandria. And of course, this is the new digital library in China, just to give you an idea of the difference between the visionary and the physical. And there's been great optimism that we could scan everything and do so. There was a vision of a universal digital library and an India digital library in 2001. They suggested that there were 100 million books and that these could all be scanned in by the year 2008. Well, ladies and gentlemen, 7 years have passed and we still haven't got all of those books in. And in the meantime, if you look at just some of the main countries in Europe, in 2007, their catalogs recognized 125 million books, and in 2015, 189 million books. In 2004, the European Commission did a study of the contents of the main libraries in Europe and came up with the figure of 2 billion, not 100 million. So, technology is changing, as you all know. So, when I was growing up, it was kilobytes. But we have megabytes, gigabytes, terabytes, petabytes, exabytes, and zettabytes. In 2003, Google pointed out that the whole of world knowledge until the year 2003 comprised 5 exabytes. They also pointed out that exabytes are growing by a rate of 5 exabytes every 2 days. Well, that sounds dramatic, but here is a chart that shows you from 2009 until 2020, we are going up to 40,000 exabytes. That's a bit more than you can have in your for breakfast, but still. And the number of computers are also changing. In 1990, the United States had 90% of the computers or internet connections. In 2015, the United States has 9% of internet connections. China now has 2 times the amount of internet connections than the population of the United States. India has more computers, internet connections than people in the United States. And by the end of this year, the people of Africa will have more computers than the people of the United States. These are dramatic figures. And so even our methods of counting are changing dramatically. So we have bytes and decabytes, hectabytes, kilobytes, megabytes, and so on. But it's growing so quickly that in the last 10 years, we've had to add 4 new categories. This was a visionary statement in the year 2000 from the BBC. 1 gram of bride DNA can hold as much information as 1 trillion CD-ROMs. This was, at the time, basically considered visionary, and it was suggested that by the year 2020 it could get into action. Well, scientific projects at places like the National Institute of Informatics started serious projects last year on this using DNA as a storage method. So those of you under 50 realize that everything we knew about computers before is not going to be there by the time you are retired. So I want to go very briefly through three basic concepts in, or four concepts, virtual reference rooms. When I got to the British Library to do my to the Warburg to do my doctorate, I arrived for the first day in this building, the British Library. I went to the desk and there was a lovely little lady, and she said, "Of course we won't be taking you seriously for the first 2 years." And I said, "Well, what do you mean, madam?" Well, she said, "This is not the library. These 400,000 books are the reference books to get to the library." And so it did actually take me about 2 years to figure out how to use those to get to the library. Well, the old Library of Alexandria had a similar concept. And in fact, all the great libraries have this kind of room. The Germans call it the Handapparat. Well, what does the reference room have? Well, it has classification systems, thesauri, terminologies, ontologies. It has titles in the form of catalogs and book catalogs. It has dictionaries, encyclopedias, partial contents in terms of abstracts, reviews, citation indexes. Now, we have in Europe, we've made a great mistake. In the great desire to make everything businesslike, we have tended to sell our reference works to companies like Zauer, which of course then got taken over by Chadwick Healy, which then got taken over by the Americans. So now all of these reference works are actually owned by foreign countries. But this is the key to understanding how we get access to our knowledge. Then, of course, there are distributed depositories. So we have the manuscripts, books, films, paintings, and other things. Then the literature about them, the comparative studies about them, the conservation work about them, and the reconstruction. So those are another four levels. And then there is going to be an area called virtual agoras, collaborative discussions, for example. Well, we were hearing about the web blogs in Iran is a precise example of that. And of course, there's the whole field of e-prints, preprints, which is now in fields like astronomy and quantum physics and so on, the norm that you can't wait 4 years to publish a major article. You put it into a preprint, it goes into Los Alamos database, and so on. So here is a vision of one of your men, Professor Balakrishnan of your country, who foresaw linking face-to-face lectures, virtual labs, and the Universal Digital Library in a complete system. This will need to be updated, but it's an example that you people in India know all of these things. You've just got to get them all working. So what I'm suggesting is that we have, most people that talk about digital libraries talk about this bit. But we need the virtual reference room and the virtual agora, and all three integrated. So we basically have, in simplified terms, 12 different layers of information. The problem with boastful places like Google is they say, they promise you they're going to give you everything. And the good news is they do give you everything, but the bad news is they don't give it to you in any order. So you type in a word like Plato's Symposium, and you get Plato's Symposium, but you get articles, you get blogs about it, but there is no order to it. And so if I want the edition of Plato by a gentleman in Oxford in the 1870s, Jowett or whatever his name was, I can't find it. Well, if I know the name, then I can find it, but that's the problem with these search engines. They expect that you know the name. And so in Google, if you know the name in Russian, you can get to the article, to some things. But if you write it in an English translation, you don't get it. So what we need is not only to scan in all of these things, but to scan in all our methods of searching for them, and then to have the links at all of these things. This is simply a schematic version of something that has to be, of course, electronic and virtual. And we need knowledge. We probably need an international knowledge organization. I'm on the board of the International Society of Knowledge Organization, but we need this probably at the world level and then national levels combining. What do I mean? Well, here is from your Digital Library of India, alphabetical list. Well, if I look at this, these are some French titles from the list. L'Empire l'immoraliste. Now, the French and the Europeans ignore the indefinite article or the definite article. And so this would be under I, that would be under E, this would be under O. And so a Frenchman coming to your dictionary could not, or your library could not find these titles. Now, this is not a criticism of you. It's simply we've got to agree that we put l'oiseau bleu under O and L under L and so on. When I was in the British Library, the British book catalog was about books. There were no articles. But now the British Library is changing so that if I look under Leonardo da Vinci, Leonardo wrote roughly 44 treatises, well, that are still extant. But now I get 5,191 books. So there's no distinction between the books Leonardo wrote and the articles about Leonardo. Well, if you know your stuff and you can search, you can figure it out. But in WorldCat, this is a much greater problem. So in WorldCat, again, there used to be only books. Now, I think 40 of my 80 articles in books are there, but the other 40 aren't. And sometimes we're looking for books, sometimes we're looking for articles, sometimes we're looking for something else. So we need to be able to distinguish, and this is not yet built into our systems. And we need to do this internationally so that if I go to a different library, which has happened in the course of my own life, that you know, you come into one library and you say, oh, it's going to take 6 months to learn the card catalog. It's going to take a year, and so on. So challenges. Well, there is a thing called the Internet Archive. They are one of the great pioneers, wonderful man that is doing this, but there is a problem. Here are some of the great pioneers in the Internet society, in the Internet development, which is a field that I have followed for the last 40 years, and I met a number of these people, like Ted Nelson and Steve Jobs and Engelbart and so on. These are their numbers for the Europeans that did things, and these are their numbers for the Americans. Well, I don't doubt that Mr. Jobs is important. Everyone agrees on that. But Alan Turing is not an inferior person. And so what's happening is we are seeing the world through the Americans' eyes, where they did it all, and Europe, who actually invented the computing, invented both in Germany and in England, who established the internet in 1968 before the Americans, that's not at all reflected in this. So we need methods that reflect, and I'm not speaking now as a Dutch person or as a European only, we need things that respect all our wonderful cultures. And this danger is increasing because now the buzzword is the Internet of Things. Well, what does the Internet of Things, buildings, energy, consumer, healthcare, industrial, transportation, retail, security, and IT? Sounds wonderful. But what about history? What about culture? What about religion? What about the fundamental, those mere 5 petabytes that account for the last 10,000 years of our civilization? They're not included in this. And their system is all built on the notion, there's a man called Mr. Khan who started TCP/IP in 1973. He wants to insert a chip into every person so that we can be followed like robots. But then he's not interested in the mind. So this is about an Internet of Things. It's a reification. But the spirit, Kaya Vakchita, this is only about Kaya, not about Vak and Chita, to sorry for my poor pronunciation of Sanskrit. The so-called Internet of Everything, which is a little slower in getting started, is even worse on this. But this is the 20-minute, or the 40-minute, and not the 40 hours, so we'll go on. So another challenge is media. We go to Google now and we get, we get everything. But here I've taken some of the major media from card catalogs of the great libraries of the world. Now, we don't always want this much. Sometimes we just want a book or an article. And this conference has been about journals for the last 10 years. But these are things that we have in our great library collections. So we need ways of focusing that if I'm a beginner user and I just want an article, I can get it. But if I want to do details, that I can get access to this. As an example, I think we're going to this building tomorrow. So I thought it would be appropriate to use it just as a matter of, par exemple, as the French say. So the Taj Mahal, we all know the building, we all know that. If you go to Google, that picture will come up almost immediately. But how many of you know that there are three in China? There are at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in India. There's one there's one four times the size of the original in Dubai. And of course, there's one in Sausalito. And of course, I did not show that one, but Mr. Trump has his own casino called the Taj Mahal. But that did not seem to me absolutely relevant here. Well, this is the one in Aurangabad, which I'll see on Monday. This is Bhopal, this is Bangladesh, this is Uttar Pradesh, and here is the four times the original size in Dubai, and this is the Hui Culture Park in, and here's another one in China, and here's another one in China, and here's one in Beijing, and here in Kokutsota, and here in Sajaya. So what we need is when I search for Taj Mahal, I want the building, obviously, but sometimes using the PMEST of Ranganathan, I want the chronological order, I want all the space versions, so these are the space versions, but we also want to see them in different media. So here's a sketch, here's a drawing, here's an engraving, here's a watercolor, here's a painting. Here's another painting. And of course, there are hundreds more paintings. I'm simply using this as an example because I've only got 4 hours. 40 minutes, yes. We also could be able to search in different media. So alabaster, marble, ivory, gold, silver, crystal, metal, copper, matchsticks, or Uncle Ben's food. Now, some of these are trivial and will be unimportant. But if we are trying to understand the depth of a culture, it's like Mona Lisa. Mona Lisa turns up on towels and all kinds of things where she didn't think she was going to be. But that's part of a true icon of culture, that it applies all across the media and has a tremendous impact. So sometimes we just want to know how to get to Agra. But sometimes we want this deeper thing. Now, our systems at the moment aren't even prepared to start with this kind of problem. But this is one of the challenges. But that's only the surface, because that is the name and the object. But the object also has a philosophy behind it. So those of you who are Indian will know what this means. It means the four gardens. I will explain. This is what we'll see tomorrow. We see the building that we all know, but unless we've been trained, we won't realize that there's 1, 2, 3, 4 gardens and 4 water courses. Those 4 water courses have a lot. Well, here you see the grand plan. It's very clear, yes? So 1, 2, 3, 4 gardens and 4 rivers. Those are the 4 rivers of paradise. In other traditions, well, also in India. Here you see it nicely, nice and clearly, and so on. So in the Indo-Islamic tradition, the Charbagh notion gets linked with a monument of death, so the mausoleum, but it is actually to represent on earth a garden as if it were in paradise. But if we looked at the history of this, we realized that there is something called Jambudvipa. You will know that there are seven dvipas, and you call it dvip in the popular. Sorry, could we have silence, please? And anyway, here we see now the four rivers. So this, the Taj Mahal that is usually seen as a fantastic example of Mughal and Islamic art, is actually a copy or inspired by Indian philosophy. Except Indian philosophy applies this to the whole world. The Taj Mahal applies it to a particular garden. In the Persian tradition, well, it goes back to Pasargadae, but those are details. But if I go to Maidan Square in Isfahan, we see that the same concept is used now for the whole city. So we have a thing for the country in India, becomes a thing for the city in Persia or Iran, and then becomes in the Arabic tradition linked with a mausoleum promising us heaven on earth. And if we go to the Christian tradition, the rivers dry up, they become the Hortus Conclusus, which is the paradise on earth, and the only thing that we have left of the water is this is a church in a gallery in Ravenna, where of course Santo Apollinare came from Antioch in the early 400s and started Christianity. Well, this became the headquarters of the Catholic Church in the early 400s. And so now the waters are only represented by this fountain in the middle. And that then 1500 years later, the Hortus Conclusus becomes the Hortus Botanicus. So we still have our charbag notion with four basic components. And this is then the botanical gardens that we find all over Europe. So when we search for Taj Mahal, unless we know the philosophy, we couldn't possibly follow this tradition. And yet it's there. So when we do the internet, well, when the internet got started, there were people like Ted Nelson and others who said, look, we need multi-links. When Tim Berners-Lee did his great job in 1989-90 to get HTTP and HTML, he basically reduced it from one link to another. Well, what we really need is hyperlinks to sources so that I can go from the source, get the manuscripts, the editions, the commentaries, and the articles. Okay, that is the main part of my talk. I now want to come to the tickling part where I show you or suggest to you where India can play a part in getting us to real problems. So everyone talks about the information in society and information management, information management and information everything. But there is also knowledge. And India developed the notion of certain means to knowledge. So information entails statements that are assumed to be true. Knowledge entails claims demonstrated to be true or for which the claims to truth are documented. In Delhi is the capital of India, India subcontinent. Those are simple things we can demonstrate quite easily. But the newer Ramayana consists of a manuscript in the British Museum and the Chhatrapati Library in Mumbai, and we have a website to show that source. Now, the problem with our internet is that if you try to link at the moment to an original picture, they tell you that that's hot linking and not allowed. But we really need, for every claim we make, we need a link so that we can check the original. We used to call it footnotes. India has been at this for quite a while, like 3,000 years, under modest conditions, and you created six different words, pratyaksa, Anunana, Apnana, Zabda, and so on. Here is the cheat sheet for those of us that don't speak Sanskrit or read Sanskrit. Those means became the basis of the six great, Charvaka, or the atheistic approach, simply had one means, only what we could see. And that basically became the Sankhya, well, the nuts of the Sankhya school, which became the basics of the 25 tattvas, which then became the 25 elements, or stoicheia in Greek. But the six methods, or the six schools of thought, then have different levels of methods. And of course, at Madras University, you have a more comprehensive list of 10 of these. Well, it means that every statement that I make, Gandhi was a great man who is buried in Delhi on such and such a date. So we can do PMST. Any sentence can be reduced to a PMST, but so can any claim that is made in the world. Our books are filled with claims, except some of those claims are based, you've been talking about bibliometrics and you're talking about the scientific field where every claim has a scientific experiment behind it, we hope. But in the history, those 5 exabytes of the last 3,000 years of culture, there, we're not sure. Sometimes Herodotus says, I heard this. Or I read this in a sacred text, so that's agama. So imagine we scan in everything, we scan in all our classification systems, but step 3 is we link every claim that is made to the levels of certain knowledge. So the most certain knowledge, of course, will have all of these things. But other things, I mean, there are sacred texts that are sacred texts and they're nothing else. We can't prove, according to the Bible in my country, God created the world, on a certain date. And the man who was the big chief, who was the chancellor of the University of Cambridge, came up with the idea that that was the year 4004 BC at 9 o'clock in the morning on the 21st of October. Now, your Vedas tell a very different story. But the point is, we're not going to fight about these things, but we want to know what the source is and have the link to that source. So that's the difference between a library approach and a Google approach at the moment that just gives us everything without any order. So I'm getting close to the end. So I've talked about the technologies, these things, and the need for integrating. So we had a European project in eCultureNet where we tried to spell this out as a distributed European resource center. So a virtual reference room, a distributed repository, and a forum for collaborative research. So you've been talking mainly about this one. Well, this story is also about bibliographical control. So this is the second part of the three things that we have to do. We scan in the whole thing and then bibliographical control. From the 10th to the 8th century, we were worried mainly about catalogs of titles. 19th century classification systems, although classification systems, as you will know from the Book of Samurin, goes back to the beginnings of time. But the main ones, the universal ones, really got started in the 18th and 19th centuries. In the 20th century, Ranganathan added faceted classification, which has also been the basis now of Bliss and so on. 20th century subject keywords and catchwords, or Sachwortkataloge in the German, and also now catalogs of articles, periodical literature, and so on. But this has to all be integrated. So that is the great challenge. So what are the challenges? Need for a tentative that one culture does not rewrite the history of others. And I just gave you the example of the internet there. Need for international cooperation on basics like alphabeticalism, Internet of Things, and everything is not enough. The Taj Mahal is an example of how we go. Instead of isolated hyperlinks, we need links to sources, manuscripts, books, editions, commentaries. We need knowledge about claims. So three steps: scanning and linking claims to knowledge is the true challenge. And hereby, the dream of universal libraries becomes transformed into universal repositories of sources, claims, and knowledge. Dhanyavaad.
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Feldman. I think that was a splendid tour de force of the way information is going to be made available and used in the future. I'd like to invite members of the audience to ask questions. We have
a few minutes. Should we have a speaker first and then have questions at the end?
No. Oh,
sorry. Okay.
We should have questions now because this, Jean-Claude Lamoureux is going to be talking about the next Colnet conference.
Okay.
Right. Anybody would like to ask questions? Yes. Can you stand up and give your name, please? There's a microphone, I think, which is coming along.
Hello. Thank you, Mr. Kim, for a good presentation. We have some tools and some softwares based on some things like FRBR, functional requirements for bibliographic records, and it's still with the knowledge and clustering knowledge in the databases and catalogs. Do you have any idea about that, and is it good to using FRBR for doing digital libraries? In that means you have aim. Thank you.
FRBR is obviously it's the tool we use at the moment, and it's fine. I mean, it's an important step forward. But what I'm talking about here is not being covered even remotely by that. So I see the role as a keynote to not just tell you what's happened, but to tickle you. I'm far away enough that far enough away that you're not in danger, but to tickle you into what you can do in the next generation, because there is a tendency amongst, especially amongst my computer science colleagues, to say, "Oh yes, we've solved everything," and everything older than 5 years ago doesn't count, and now we're going to solve everything. Of course, they haven't read anything; they don't know anything.
But they know the last 5 years, and the last 1 year or 2 years.
What's going on? Why is... Okay. We need a much more universal approach to things. The last real effort on this was Otlet and La Fontaine. Well, 1911, there was an important conference in Berlin, where Marie Curie and all of these people got together about this. Then La Fontaine started the Montanéum, and that was an important thing. In the late 30s, there was a man called Goldberg who had a notion of micro-knowledge, and he decided to get all of that onto micro-videos. And of course, his whole ideas were stolen by a man called Vannevar Bush, and that's the article that everyone in the America reads as if, and but the whole Memex thing was a copy of the German Russian Jew who had invented this 20 years earlier. And of course, the Americans always talk about Vannevar Bush. They never know about Goldberg, and they never know that it started in Russia and came to Germany, and it was in Leipzig where they got it down to having microfilm, and the whole notion of university microfilm, that all got started in Germany. So, to answer your question, yes, it's helpful, but it is not yet the big picture.
Thank you very much. Speaker down here.
Myself, Ravi Kumar. Regarding this digital archiving and the internet archive, metadata plays a vital role for retrieval of this kind of virtual information. When we talk about metadata, we have different standards. For example, if for image, we have a different standard. For video images, we have different standards. Whether we can have a common platform for these kind of documents so that there will be no overlap or mismatch between the metadata standards. So for example, in an internet, we have all kinds of documents, starting from text to scanned document, but we can't go for each one to have a separate metadata standard. So how do you think that we can have a common metadata standard for it?
Well, sir, is this a 1 minute question or another lecture? There's a man called Leonardo Chiariglione. If you are an expert in this field, you will know the name. But he is an Italian who went to Japan and did a doctorate. And he got MPEG 4 started, then he got MPEG 7 started, and then he got fed up with the politics and got MPEG 21 started. So there have been efforts in this for the last 100 years. One of the great problems is that Europe makes a serious effort and the Americans make a less serious effort and, of course, insist that theirs is the right one. And then everybody gets excited. But when we look at the statistics now, as I said, the United States is 9% of the internet. I remember going to Yokohama in 2000, and a little gentleman got up. He was about 5'4". It was the shortest lecture I ever heard. He said, "My name is Professor Zhou Zhongbun from the Chinese Academy of Sciences. We are not happy with the way you're treating us. May I remind you that we are older than you and bigger than you. And if you do not behave, we will create our own internet and forget you. Thank you very much." And he sat down. Well, slightly exaggerate. I mean, the poor Americans didn't know that. Well, half of them were already on their plane to the next conference, but the others didn't know how to deal with this. The point is, you and China, just the two of you, and of course you've got Persia here now as well. So, but if you put yourselves together, you are a third of the world. You are 50% of the internet, not 9%. So that isn't to say we should be rude to Americans. I like Americans. I just don't like the system that tries to tell me that that little bit of people has control of the whole world. So we must, as the great old nations of the world, I mean, I'm only from Europe, so there was a civilization in Maastricht in 20,000 BC, but still, compared to your country, this is nothing. So, we must get the great countries to work together and create our own standard. I want to access a thing. I have to go to Adobe, and Adobe wants to do this and that with my information. I don't want them to do this and that, but there's no alternative. Why haven't we got a European or an Indian or a Chinese Adobe? Why haven't we got it for all of these things? And so we should create our own standard that applies to the majority, and then, of course, work with the Americans and work with everyone, but not let them, in a tiny little committee, tell the world. So.
Thank you very much. One more question.
I'm Dr. Ranjita from Gujarat.
And your
talk is very excellent. We came to know about the update technology. But one thing I need to ask you, that is, you discuss about that internet and the third position in India, and about the virtual agoras. But the basic thing I need to ask you, I know about that hyperlink, but how the polyfunctional hyperlink, the omnilink, that how it can be worked and how it can be worked out when I create the links about the library collection, we put that link that in our library or institute IP address or institute IR, how it can be worked, that I need to know.
Well, I have some of models to show how it might work, but this is something to get it working as a standard really requires. I used to have chats with Tim Berners-Lee, and then he became Tim Berners-Lee, and slowly he announced one day in an interview that I was no longer relevant. So I wrote an article on the internet and the culture and culture in information technology in 2004. I think you'll find this all on my website. We to get this working across languages. I mean, you have 26 mother languages in this country, and so you have done. You and Russia are the two greatest places for dealing with multilingualism. I mean, not just the 27 languages or the 28 languages of Europe, but in the institute in Moscow does 125 languages in their library. I have no simple answer for you. You could read, if you come to me later, I'll give you my email and I'll send you an article or two on it.
Professor Kim,
thank you very much.
I just want to know, is there any live model from the Netherlands regarding the universal digital library of your country? What kind of technique you have discussed in your presentation? Is there any live model is there?
No, I have a demo called System for Universal Media Searching, which is very primitive. It has 400,000 words, which is nothing. That would be a demo in itself. This is not, I can't do two things at once. So I could at some point give a lecture on that, but that's not the order of the day.
Thank you very much. I'd like to stop now because that we have to allow time for Jean-Claude Larmirel, who is our next speaker, who will be telling us about the plans for the next Colnet conference. Dr. Larmirel, please.
Do you hear me? Good. So it's my pleasure to present the next edition of the Colnet conference in 2015. And this will be the 12th edition of the conference and the 17th Colnet meeting. Okay. I make a mistake on the date, I'm sorry. This is on December, this will happen on December 12th to 15th, 2016, that in Strasbourg in France. So you have a picture of the old Strasbourg city. This is a panoramic picture, so you see that it's a very old city and it's preserved, so it's a beautiful place to come. So I will briefly give you a video presentation of the Strasbourg city, which has been performed by the New York Times. So it's there is some English presentation inside. So then I will tell you shortly about conference location, the important preliminary topics for the conference, then also the important date, of course. And I will speak also finally of the partnerships and funding for the conference. Right. Okay. So this is where is the video? No, where is the video? The video is not here. Mm-hmm. So could you launch the video from your computer? Okay. Doesn't work? Oh, my pardon. Yes, sure.
just 1 minute for presentation of the. There was a problem with the computer, and I cannot connect my computer on the projector.
If you have a laptop, you can.
No, it doesn't work.
Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. This one. No. I was fearing that there was a problem with this computer, and that's okay. So I'm sorry, because this is a computer problem. It works perfect on my computer, but we cannot connect it here. I'm really sorry. Anyway, so I can give you the link. I will give you the link on the video. You can play by yourself. Okay. So what is important to know is Strasbourg is the settlement of European Parliament also. So this is also a modern city. This is a mix between German influence and French influence. That it's very unique in France. This mixing, because the city has been occupied by German for a while. And they build up their own city inside the area of Strasbourg, and there was also the remaining old city from the 15th century, which is very beautiful, taking part in the UNESCO patrimony. So it's a most important city on the east of the country, in any case. Okay. So, and Alsace is a particularly beautiful and a specific region in France. They have their own culture and their own patrimony. This is the place where I will probably set the conference. This is the campus. The University of Strasbourg is located mainly in the center of Strasbourg. So all the buildings of the university are in the same place. It's in the very, very heart of the city. So there is there will be some available place for us to come here. So what is important to point out here. So of course, the usual topic of the conference will be welcome, and as well as librarian also are welcome, because it's the first time we have so much librarian in the conference, and this is a good point, to my opinion. So you are welcome to come again for the next meeting in Strasbourg. So, and of course, we have discussed about this many times, and also my colleague discussed about the big data context. I think it's important to put the focus on this big data context in different way. So we will try to give you some hints on the technique for big data analysis. So I'm planning to have some colleague of mine coming to talk about that, okay? But also, which would be interesting, is to have some scientometric study on related to the big data context. So this is more the task of you to provide some studies on this area. There were already some studies this year on this area, but I think we must continue, because it's an important point. So I planned some plenary talk. Also, can be a bit technical talk, so we can even think about tutorial if you need. Okay, transform some talk into tutorial. So I will make some proposal, and then you can react and tell me if you are interested in tutorial rather than, for example, plenary talk. So for example, clustering on graph mining. Okay, So this is things which are really important and on your domain. So I need, I think we need to have some, you know, special knowledge about that, and this could be important for you too. So we can plan something like this. Visualization and management of dynamic data is also important because we are living in a dynamic world. And again, we have seen this just before. So dynamic in terms of increasing of, you know, information availability, and also, but also in the sense that the information is changing continuously. So this is important, and also in big data management. So other plenary talk, of course, will concern the centrometrics and bibliometric area. So my colleague here, which are centrometrician, will be welcome to make that talk. So the important date, so the end of 2015, these dates are correct, this time, will be the conference announcement and the CFP release. Okay. So we plan to put the deadline on April 30 for the extended abstract for oral presentation. Of course, again, the abstract will be must be consistent, at least 3 pages, because we want to understand what we want to talk about. So it's a normal situation that to have long abstract available for a further, you know, a full paper. So take care about that, because we don't want too short information. The acceptance notification for the abstract will be on May 20. So then also it will be the deadline for the poster presentation proposal, okay, 1 pages, and the deadline for the full paper will be end of July. This is for the time, the tentative deadline, but we can shift a bit because we have a bit time to manage that. So, and the deadline for registration will be November 30, not 1:30, because it's not it's a available date. And we plan in December and the conference time also to include some poster highlights, because I think poster highlights are important for people to get an hint of what the poster are speaking about, and it's good for the poster presenter also to have some small slot to talk about their work, instead of just talking about their work on the poster place, to have some 1 or 2 minutes short presentation of their poster. It could be good for the people to understand and to be more curious about what is done in the poster work. Right. Okay. So we have also planned a partnership, because there is this is a hard task to organize everything. We plan a partnership with Indian colleague for website management, editing of paper, proceeding of books, and sponsorship. For the funding issue, we try to make as much as possible special registration fee for emerging countries, okay, and we are still searching for additional funding here for, you know, funding some travel or things like this if possible. And then also, of course, a good idea would be to have a special issue in a journal. So we try to contact Centrometrics editor and to plan some special issue on the next CONNECT meeting on Centrometrics, or even on the Journal of Infometrics. So I'm really sorry for the video, because the video are very good, so, and very interesting. So I cannot. So I will give you some link in order to see the video by yourself. Right. So by the fact you, I thank you very much, and we hope to see you in Strasbourg in December 2015. Right.
Thank you very much.
We really hope to have the maximum participation for this next conference, and you will not regret to come to France, and especially in East Strasbourg. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have a question, however, before we go too far. You've asked for full papers to be prepared and submitted nearly 6 months in advance of the conference. I would have thought that was really rather too long, and many people's research will not be at a state that they would want to commit themselves to a full paper. Would it not be possible to have the dates put back so that full papers are submitted by, say, the end of September? That would give you nearly 3 months to prepare the proceedings.
Yes, yes, we can do this. That's what I've said, because we have time. We can shift the deadline for the...
I think that would be very desirable, because otherwise, absolutely. For example,
That's a good remark. That's what I more or less anticipated before, but we can do this.
Okay. Yes, okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Grant, for your remark.
Sorry?
Is there any question? Yeah. Oh, okay. So what is interesting?
I'm sorry.
I must tell this. What is interesting in December in Strasbourg is the Christmas time. There is a beautiful Christmas market in Strasbourg. This is the best Christmas market in all Europe. So it's interesting to visit Strasbourg at that time because of this specific event. So, and this is also an opportunity to spend Christmas time with some of friends or your family in the surrounding, if you have, right? So, I will put some links on that for you, because, yeah, I'm really sorry about that. Yeah.
Right, thank you very much.
Yeah.
I've been asked to allow Professor Rao to say a few words about the Colnet Journal.
Just let me thank the chair to give me a chance to come and say a few words about it. Just two or three sentences, not more than that. As practiced in the earlier conference, Colnet conferences, this year also we are planning to invite selected papers which were presented in this conference to publish in the Colnet Journal in 2016, either in the June issue or in the December issue. So, in this regard, if the authors who are interested in submitting the papers can submit to Colnet Journal, provided you have to considerably revise the article. We will acknowledge it, saying that it has been presented here, but because of some pressure from the publisher, they don't like to publish an article in our journal once it is already published. So we expect that you will revise considerably based on your experience and the presentation here, and the revised articles will be published in the Colnet Journal. Again, as per the formalities, it will be refereed. Now, most likely the invited papers are likely to be in June issue and other thing in the December issue. So you can directly send the articles to me, say, in the next 2 to 3 months, but at least in the next, within a month, you send me email whether you are willing to submit it, revised paper, not as such. If it is presented as such, publisher will make using by software, they say it is already published, etc., etc. They are not willing to publish it. We have recently had some bad experience in this regard. Try to revise it based on the feedback you got it at the presentation, and then try to submit it. Second thing I would like to say, Colnet Journal is becoming popular among the users in Scientometrics, and you can go through the Google Scholar and you can see that good number of articles are getting citations, and we are also putting our efforts to include it in the Web of Science. And I request all the Colnet members to subscribe to Colnet Journal. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Rao. We'll finish the session now, because we're now going straight on to two parallel sessions, one of which is session 6A, which will be in this...
Want to add something? Can I add something?
So session 6A will be in this hall, and session 6B we'll be starting right away upstairs in room B, where there is an invited talk by Sujit Bhattacharya to start with.
Okay.
So I'd like to finish the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, honorable delegates on dais and in the hall. I request Mr.
I just want to add something, if you don't mind. Okay, of course, for the next year, you are also welcome to publish in the Colnet Journal. I just forgot to say this, but it's important also that you plan to submit your participation for the next year in the Colnet Journal, of course.
Thank you, sir. I request Mr. Grant Levison to give a memento to Mr. Kim H. Weltman.
Oh, very well. Here you are. I think you want to pick those.
It would be nice. And I also request Mr. Jane Charles Lemire to facilitate the memento to Dr. Sanjay Kataria for co-chairing the session. Thank you very much. It's just a matter of 5 minutes. We are just arranging for the next session here, 6A. And as the chair has already communicated, that the session 6B will be upstairs.
Under the circumstances.
Thank you. Knowledge Service Measurement. To chair this session, I would like to invite Mrs. Shashi Prabha Singh, our former professor from Delhi University. Professor Mrs. Shashi Prabha Singh, MSc in Zoology, acquired all professional qualifications from University of Delhi. She joined Delhi University Library System in 1978, then joined teaching in Department of Library and Information Science in 1987. She taught in the department for more than 28 years, guided several MPhil and PhD scholars. She is actively involved in research and academic activities. She is on the editorial board of several national and international journals, including Emerald International. She retired in July 2014. Recently, she has been awarded UGC Emeritus Fellowship for 2 years. Kindly, ma'am, Professor Shashi Prabha Singh. Ma'am, please take a seat. Now, I would like to invite our co-chairing for this session, Dr. Sushmita Chakravarti. Ma'am, please take a seat. For this session, as an invited speaker, we have Dr. Tariq Ashraf. Sir, please kindly come on dais. Now, I request Dr. Shiva Chitambaram to kindly present a flower to Dr. Shashi Prabha Singh. I request Mr. Deepak Sharma to kindly present a flower to our invited speaker, Dr. Tariq Ashraf. I request Dr. Shri Ram to kindly present a bouquet of flowers to our co-chair, Dr. Sushmita Chakravarti. Now I request the chair of this session, Professor Shashi Prabha Singh, to kindly carry on this session. Thank you, ma'am.
Good morning, everybody. Honorable Professor Hildren, founder Colnet, Professor I. K. Ravichandra Rao, Professor Sangam, I am able to see very many senior professional colleagues and dear participants. It's a great pleasure for me to be here in this morning for this session, which is on a very special topic, which has become a very important area of research. And I did a study on PhD trends, research trends in LIS, and there I found this was one of the area which was having maximum number of research. Of course, number was more in bibliometrics. So this is a very important area, time-tested area, I would say, on which this conference has been held. And moreover, this has become a time of specialization. We are heading for more and more specialization. So in that context, this area is very important. I would like to convey my sincere thanks to Dr. P.K. Jain, Dr. Tariq Ashraf, and all the organizers of this conference who has invited me or given me the opportunity to meet you all, because it's always a pleasure. It provides me immense pleasure to meet the professionals, because such occasions provide an opportunity to see each other. So thank you very much, all the organizers of this conference. We are going to start with the keynote address, which will be delivered by Dr. Tariq Ashraf. And there is a slight change in the title of the topic, which has been listed on the schedule. The topic is Repositioning Academic Libraries, Managing the Transition. This will be delivered by Dr. Tariq Ashraf. I would like to say a few things about Dr. Ashraf. You know, it's always a reverse way that Tariq has been addressing me all the times whenever I have been chairing sessions, but this time I feel very happy that I am getting a chance to introduce Tariq for his keynote address. He did his library science from the University of Delhi, and presently he is heading a very important place of Delhi University Library System, that is South Delhi Campus Library. And I had visited his library. In fact, he has changed the overlook of the library, and all of you should visit that library. He is working there since last 9 years. He has earlier worked in a very important benchmark institution, that is IIM Lucknow, as a librarian. He is a prolific author. He has been writing for LIS literature and undertaken an extensive 3-volume documentation of India's parliamentary election since their inception in 1952. That's a 3-volume work and very well prepared. He has also published twice the IGI Global USA. Dr. Ashraf is a recipient of Eugene Garfield Travel Grant and also Distinguished Member Award for SLA in the year 2013. He is also twice winner of international paper contest held by American Society for Information Science, which is a very important internationally reputed organization. He is a board member of SLA Asian chapter since 2009 and treasurer of Asian Library Association. I have seen this thing with my own experience that Dr. Jain, Dr. Debalkar, Ganguly, and Dr. Tariq, they had been organizing that SLA conference. SLA chapter is now available with India, and they are the backbone of that chapter in India. With these words, I invite Dr. Tariq Ashraf for delivering his lecture. Before Dr. Ashraf starts his address, I would like to introduce my co-chair, Dr. Sushmita Chakravarti also. She is a gold medalist of Calcutta University. She has done 4 master's degree and a PhD in medical informatics. She has been awarded SLA Rising Star Award in 2015 and Bonnie Hilditch International Librarian Award in 2013. She is the secretary of IFLA section on education and training and past secretary of the SLA Asian chapter. She is currently an assistant professor in Calcutta University. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your kind words. And very good morning to everyone. This is my indeed a privilege and honor to be here this morning and to make this small presentation. There is a change in the topic of my talk as informed, because I thought that probably this matrix is more important, as we have already had a lot of discussion on cytometrics and webometrics. Let me start my submission by saying that academic libraries are under serious pressure. They are under serious challenge from different quarters. And there is a very strong need for repositioning the academic libraries. How this repositioning can take place is basically through innovation, through technology, through application of technology, and through value-added services. There is a complete transformation in the information landscape. Physical books are now being, entire physical material, in fact, is under serious change, and it is being replaced by digital material. So that is basic transformation. Some would say that this challenge has been there for last many, many years, and we have been talking since 1960s, 70s that libraries under pressure since the beginning of computerization. But this time, this is what I feel, that challenge is really strong, and this transformation is really happening on our watch. This is happening before our eyes. There are basically essentially 4 drivers which are leading this change, and these drivers are basically unsustainable cost, declining usage, viable alternatives, and new patron demands. So these are 4 basic engines which are leading this change in the academic milieu. Coming to the cost of journals is crowding out everything. Particularly the system of bouquet, where you don't have the option of choosing one particular title. You have to go for an entire database. That is really putting a lot of pressure.
Serial expenditure, this bundled subscription to journals and electronic databases are stretching the limits of the library budget. Now, there are, even this cost is outpacing the inflation. Within inflationary limits, this is always justifiable to go for higher cost. But when pricing even outpaces the inflation, that it really becomes difficult to manage the costs. Now, this pressure is so much that even the best libraries have given up this race of building best libraries in the world. This is a report from the Harvard University, which has in 2010 its report agreed that now more important issue is to build collection from anywhere, to provide access from anywhere, rather than to collect everything. So the best institutions in the world now basically, you know, are also under pressure to develop the so-called best library in the world. That tag is no longer important as far as the ranking and the prestige of the
So now the model is to ensure access, not necessarily ownership of scholarly materials needed by faculty, students, and other library users. There is a visible decline in the usage of the library. All the statistics show that the lonely reference librarian. There are hardly reference queries. Now you are connected all 24/7 with a smartphone libraries virtually in your pocket. The statistics are going. Even the traditional issue return data shows that there is substantial decline in the usage. And if you look into the literature, you will find that hardly any research, or most of the research is not starting in the libraries, not even from the library website. It is starting, they are opting instead for search engines and discipline-specific search resources. So now user has viable alternatives available to him and her. Circulation and reference requests have been declining for years. The metrics are under change, as I said in the beginning. The traditional metrics of measuring the performance are under serious challenge. The earlier metrics of number of users who visited the library, the gate count, the footfalls, number of books issued are no longer matters. The new metrics are how much library is influencing the research, how much libraries are contributing to the research, how libraries are helping in the retention of the students, how they are contributing to the faculty research. So these are the new metrics which academic libraries have to take into account. They cannot go by number that so many people visited the library, so many books we have issued, so many reference queries we have answered. These metrics are no longer valid. Size does not matter. Size is no longer a parameter for measuring the performance. It is the new matrix. It is the contribution to the research which has to be taken into account. Collection size is rapidly losing the importance. This used to be, you know, a permanent kind of parameter. How many books you have? 2 lakh. Oh, well, good library. Now, nobody asks for how many books you have. What kind of access you are providing? What kind of services you are providing to the researchers? That is more current matrix. So this collection arm race, like, you know, US Soviet arm race in Cold War era, is no longer valid now. We have to abandon this collection arm race and to focus more on provided access. And the new pattern is more smart than what we can even anticipate. they want access at their own timing. A student wakes up around midnight and he wants to have access to the library resources. Time and space are no longer the limits. They are, you know, no longer the constraint. So we have to accordingly transform the services whereby the libraries are available anytime, anywhere. And this viable alternative, you know, look, there's a scale which is beyond imagination. Look at these alternatives, Amazon, Wiki, HathiTrust. They are into massive digitization. They are providing everything online. Google is a remarkable company. The purpose of the objective of Google is to digitize everything what is available on the earth. And they are working in this direction very effectively also. It is unmatchable kind of situation where library just cannot match with Google. The Google has tremendous capacity to capture everything on the earth available and make it. There are, of course, copyright issues, but even these are being managed through different platforms, through different mechanisms. More emphasis on capturing the data and making it available. Of course, there is free information available on the web, and which is accessible. Web is more easier, more accessible than library databases. Declining statistics create problem when library wants funding. So these all kinds of situations are building up to the pressure, and libraries have to always justify whatever expenditure they are making. Growing perception that physical library is no longer essential. Web-based teaching. Courses are being delivered through web-based modules, and lecture notes are available. As you must have seen, there are a lot of vendors in this area. Now you just do not require physical structure. Even the universities are coming up, click universities, where everything is available online. The lectures are available online. And in next 20 years, 25 years, I suppose that this is going to be the major transformation in the entire educational landscape. Growth of digital libraries, access from anywhere, multiple users, same resources, round the clock, availability of all, you know, these what kind of facilities digital library provides. E-books, the free and print, non-print out of items are available, and they have useful for short-term browsing. Google, I talked about Google. University of Michigan estimated time to scan all of their 7 million volumes in 1,000 years. This was about 25 books per day. Very justifiable, reasonable kind of estimate which University of Michigan took into account, but Google has done it in just 6 years' time. Seven volumes digitized in six years' time. So 1,000 years versus 6 years. So that is the capacity of the Google. So now the fear is that, like music industry, library may be the next media outlet to be disintermediated, where you just do not require any human interface. People can go to the library, they can browse, they can download, they can read, like music, which is available, you know, without any human intervention. So this is what is coming up in literature, that maybe the libraries are the next target of this disintermediation. These are other signs. Change in the demographic, students change more rapidly than library staff, decrease in funds. This is probably the point which I would like to emphasize, that there is a shift in view of education funding from public good to private advantage. There is a philosophical change that education is no longer public good, like public transport or a road which government builds. Road is used by everyone, public transport is used by everyone, but education is not benefiting everyone. So there is a perceptual change, even Europe and American universities systems, that education how much government should fund the education, because it is no longer being perceived as public good. It is benefiting few people. So there is tremendous amount of pressure on the budgets. There are, you know, budget cuts being applied. Even in our country, there has been substantial decrease in the budget in the higher education, only due to this pressure. So this is like writing our own obituary. This is the forum of the Taiga Forum in 2010-11 that made this statement that successful libraries will be those who have managed to turn over the majority of their staff or resigned or reassigned staff to different roles within the library. Most library space will be taken over by functions that have nothing to do with the library collection or services. So this is a sign of warning that library needs to repurpose their collection, library needs to repurpose even their staff, redeploy the staff because of these changes. So what has to be the response? How we have to manage this transformation? That is the basic question. This transformation has to be done through repositioning, re-engineering, reinventing, or through technological interventions. We have to recognize the changing nature of the collection, design new libraries, meet changing expectations of the students, train staff for new roles, and design new library spaces. Collection has to be made more visible. We have to focus on collection which is being used heavily, which is more active collection. We have to bring it forward. We have to use new discovery tools for making the collection more visible. Instead of having a large collection, what we require is a collection which is being used by the, so that in a sense the entire collection of the libraries has to be repurposed. You must have seen, you must have even done it, you know, shopping on Myntra. Whenever you buy a dress, you immediately get a review that 100 people have bought this shirt. So that immediately, you know, kind of rating which you know about this shirt. 100 people who have bought this shirt have also bought this shirt. So that is a ready reference available. So this kind of discovery services can be done for the books also. 100 people have already also searched this kind of book. Or 100 people have also borrowed this book which you are borrowing. And there is availability of instant rating also. Like in Facebook, you can like, dislike. So immediately you can write a review. The social media platform allows this kind of facility. So this is repurposing the collection. So we have to recognize that postmodern collection is not limited to physical location, local and remote paper and electronic. The students are now, there is also pressure on the space. Learning is taking place in collaboration. It is no longer in isolation. So entire library space has to be accordingly redone. Where you can have spaces where the student can discuss, they can grapple with the ideas. It is no longer a silent zone. You have to provide this kind of facilities. Remember, it is the world of ideas. The entire economy is being driven by the new ideas. Facebook, if you look at the Facebook, it is a very simple idea, but it is a $1 billion product today. So these are the ideas which are driving, fueling the economic growth. Startup, the entire economy is being led up by startups. Students come out of the IIT, they sit in a room for a week time, they grapple with the ideas and come out with a product. So why not library become the hub of ideas instead of hub of collection, hub of unused books, volumes, large number of volumes. So that is the basic idea of repurposing the entire space. Leveraging digital collection, ebooks adoption reaching a tipping point from more sale on Amazon. This is data is available that now Amazon is selling more ebooks than print books. So again, we have to prioritize the collection and go in a large number for electronic sources. Pattern-driven acquisition models where it allows to just-in-time purchasing approach. No longer building up, buying up books in anticipation, but based on the actual need of the patron. So that is the basic repurposing. Libraries have to provide different kind of academic supports. They have to help in the research. They have to become a place of learning commons where everything, all the academic commons are put together. Computing facilities are available at one place. Other instructional facilities are also available within the library premises so that it becomes an academic common kind of situation where a student can access anything, everything from the library premises. The reference service, which used to be a core service of the libraries in earlier times, it can be now, you know, taken over by question.org, which replies to your reference queries immediately. Then a lot of reference queries can be outsourced also, crowdsourced rather, where the reference answers are available from people. There are a lot of websites which allow this kind of facility. So this is the changing expectation and how this entire computer reference IT study areas have to be together. And libraries have to go where the students are. Embedded librarianship, this is the concept. You have to completely integrate with the student's requirement, and whatever information requirement is there, libraries have to completely part of that, become a part of, integral part of the core research requirement. Like libraries can have access to the research proposals. When they have access to these research proposals, they can in anticipate, prepare the literature which is required by the researcher or the faculty members. Libraries will need to similarly engage in with graduate students, research teams and faculty if they intend to regain the relevance and value. Libraries can also take the help of the specialists, because librarians are not the specialists. They are basically have training in basic training in subject, but what they can do is that they can take help from postdoctoral students, from faculty members. We can have a system like there are subject librarians who can help in identifying the requirement, in identifying the subject. So there is a system in McMaster University. Many of these needs are now met by non-librarians, often postdoctoral scholars. Traffic on the web, it can be leveraged for course support, where the relevant portion of the web-based material can be linked on the library website and made available prominently. Collaboration with teaching faculty in incorporating IT and multimedia resources. Coming to the staff, even the library staff has to be redeployed, new competencies have to be built, and new skills have to be provided to meet this transformation. We can externalize the low impact activity. Cataloging no longer a local activity. As you know, cataloging of books is taking place at several places. So catalog cards can always be downloaded. Tiered reference services, where important reference queries are answered by the librarians and less important reference queries are answered by the lower staff. So a tier kind of reference services. Crowdsource reference matches supply. Embedded librarianship. So there is a need for cross training to handle technical questions and reference needed. Access to wide variety of formats. So these are the new skills. Libraries create new units to deal with digitization, software, electronic journals, copyright, data services, database development, marketing, instructional design, and I would like to add one more, that is fundraising. It is now an emerging role of the libraries to mobilize funds also. There are various avenues available for fundraising. And so these all have to be part of the planning, this architect, librarians, libraries, IT, faculty planning, engineering, security, cyber security particularly, where they all become partners in this planning. Library buildings have to be like this. plan for greater computer capacity than currently needed, wireless, e-print system, self-check service out, smart card, AV cable carriers, meeting, training and conference areas, overhead lighting to make it possible to put computers in one airy area, heating and ventilation should take computer heat into account, coating and location of windows should reduce glare on screen. So this is how even the library spaces, library buildings have to be replanned. Size of the standard collection may shrink, so portion of the library may be turned to other uses such as instructional spaces, building-wide cabling. So whenever we plan, there should be building-wide cabling where the computers can be made available from anywhere. Roof-mounted dishes for satellite access. Modular furniture, network connection, CD, DVD, burner, webcam with microphone. So these are the small facilities which libraries have to plan when there are new buildings coming up, so that the connectivity is there, so that access is there. So this is all what I have to say for this morning. I hope that made some useful. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tariq. He has delivered a, he has given a very good exposure about what as a librarian we need, what as a, in fact, the time is changing and changing at such a fast speed that we are forced to have repositioning. If we don't change, we'll have to change according to the time, otherwise time is definitely going to reject us. But I don't know, we can say libraries without wall, but libraries without librarian, it's a serious thought. I don't know how can we think about. Of course, people say that there is no need of the librarian at all. But when we were a student, we used to sit in the library. We used to enjoy that kind of time, that sitting with 5-6 books, making notes, sitting. Other people are also studying. That used to motivate us. And always, full library full of users motivates the librarian. Class full of students motivate the teacher. I don't know. Libraries without wall, what will happen? But I mean, the time can be that library is exactly without anybody.
Can I add just one
thing? Yeah, please.
Okay. Actually, I just want to add two lines with this stimulating comment. Dr. Tariq Ashraf's paper pointed out the gravity of the situation, which is really alarming. But there is this ray of hope that he has presented in his paper, and which is repositioning, rebranding your library. And I think we all librarians, both teacher librarians and practicing librarians, be aware of this fact and be warned and take his advice of repositioning the library so that we are still relevant in the coming century or so. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let us continue with the session. Then the questions we can take up later.
He has already given so many advices. In this paper.
Full of.
I'm talking about those papers. His paper is full of those advices.
We are having 4 papers in this session, and I would just like to see how many are already there. The contributory paper first is by R. Prabhakaran and Shalini Lihitkar. Acha, Prabhakaran sir is there. Next is Imran Mukhtar Mahajan, Mudassir Khazar, Huma Shafiq, and Uzma Qadri. Second paper is by the group of 4. And is anybody there from this group? No? We can divide the time. No? That's the reason. Then Siva Chidambaram is there. Yes. Shri Ram Sanjay Kataria. Sanjay Kataria is there. Shri Ram is there. Okay, that means we'll be now dividing the time between 3. Now invite Dr. R. Prabhakaran and Shalini, jointly written by Shalini Lihitkar. The area is Wiser Ranking of Astronomy and Astrophysics Libraries website. This Wiser word is very important here. I would like to see Wiser Ranking. Please come.
Thank you, madam. Very good morning. Respected co-chair and Dr. Tariq, and invited guests and delegates. My presentation on Wiser Ranking of Astronomy Astrophysics Library websites. I am Prabhakaran, working in Tata Staff Under Research, Mumbai. Over a few decades, the importance of electronic communication and the internet has increased significantly. The web has a greater impact on communication and society than perhaps any other technology. The backdrop of webomatics is bibliometrics and World Wide Web. Quantitative study of the World Wide Web termed webomatrics. It is a science based on informatics methods which studies the nature and characteristics of websites. There are different webomatic ranking methods followed for the website ranking, such as Web Impact Factor ranking, Google Page Rank, Alexa Traffic Rank, etc. And one of them is Weiser ranking. It is explored to rank the astronomy astrophysics library websites through Web Indicator for Science, Technology and Innovation Research, that is known Weiser. Aguilio et al. In 2005. It includes Professor Hilden, who have introduced Weiser with a survey of the tools that can currently be used to measure the structure and nature of the web. The purpose of the study is to collect and analyze the number of web pages, the number of inlinks, rich files of astronomy astrophysics library websites, and to calculate and rank the websites according to Weiser. The analysis has been carried out on astronomy astrophysics library websites in the world. The study was limited to the website specific to astronomy astrophysics libraries for comparison and ranking. If there is a library which any other subjects like physics, mathematics is excluded from the analysis. Astronomy is the oldest natural science, deals with the celestial objects, space, and physical universe as a whole. Astrophysics is a branch of astronomy, deals with the physical nature of stars and other celestial bodies. Astronomy astrophysics tests were carried out nearly in 405 institutions, universities from 47 countries. Only 55 astronomy astrophysics library websites are available in 24 countries, because I said that physics, mathematics or engineering, any other subjects deals with the websites which they have other sources, then it has been excluded from the study. So it is only limited to 55 libraries. This is a sample of astronomy astrophysics libraries in India and other parts of the world. So I have done 55, this is only the sample. The full details are available in the proceedings. What are the research methodology followed? The Astronomy Astrophysics Institution, Astronomy Astrophysics Research carried out institutions and universities have been identified by referring to Encyclopedia of Astronomy Astrophysics. Each institution websites were browsed to find out these specific subject areas and filtered other subjects. As I said, there only the libraries that have proper website or web page were selected for research study. If there is only search engine or only one contact information or only brief information, one page, this has been excluded for the study. Webomatics tools such as web crawler software SociBot for full version and search engine optimization tools were used for this study. The Weiser ranking is based on four indicators, namely size, visibility, rich files and scholar. They are combining according to the following formula for the Weiser ranking. WR Weiser ranking is equal to log. The 50% visibility weightage is given, for size 20%, for rich files 15%, and Google Scholar 15%. The visibility is the external links received by the website. Size is the total number of web pages in the website. Rich files are PDF, script files, Microsoft Doc file, and PowerPoint PPTs available in the website. And Scholar is the number of papers, citations, reports, and other academic items retrieved from Google Scholar. For each website, this data were collected, computed, log normalized, and ranking is done. The required data on total number of web pages has been extracted using SociBot software. The data on inlinks have been extracted using search engine optimization tool backlinkswatch.com. Like I said, rich files are collected through Google Scholar, Google search engine by using the search index. Example, if it is a site, the file you type as a PDF, then you will retrieve how many PDFs are in the particular website. This is a sample of rich file of the websites of astronomy astrophysics libraries. The first is the PDF, the second one is PostScript, third is a Microsoft Doc file and PowerPoint presentations. PDF, you can see most of them have, majority has a PDF, where it can be commonly used by many of them.
WISER are measured based on link analysis that combines the number of external links and the number of pages of the websites. A ratio of 1:1 between visibility and size, and number of documents measured from the number of rich files in a website domain, number of publications being collected by Google Scholar database. The four indicators like size, visibility, rich files, and Scholar are combined according to the following formula, which I already stated. The data collected for each website were computed and log normalized. Ranking has been assigned on basis of a highest value to lowest value. The sample of 1 to 10 ranking, WISER ranking of Astronomy SFL libraries. We can see the number of web pages, that is the size. The second is the in-link, that is the visibility. Rich file is R, and Google Scholar, what are the, it's a domain, it's based on the domain analysis, and then WISER ranking. So Harvard Smith Center for Astrophysics has already ranked first according to WISER ranking. The total 55 ranking is been in the proceedings. What are the findings? The analysis revealed that the Royal Astronomical Society Library UK has highest number of web pages, like that 6,653 web pages. However, it ranked 23rd position due to its visibility, which is low. That is, in-link is very, it has a citation is very less. Astronomy Library Boston University USA has the highest visibility. It has more in-links, but ranked third due to its Google Scholar hits are very low. As per WISER method, Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics Library was ranked first with 11,478 in-links, that is visibility, 191 number of web pages, that is size, and 10,81,500 rich files, and 5,70,000 results from Google Scholar. Astronomy Society for South Australia Library website ranked lowest, that is 55th rank, with 1,663 in-links, visibility, and 2 number of web pages, and 32 rich files, and only 24 results from the Google Scholar. The conclusion is that the analysis indicates that website with a high number of rich files and high number of results from Google Scholar ranks better as per WISER. It has also been ascertained from the computational data analysis that website with rich files of PDF format remains on the first place. The WISER indicators have big impact on web performance. Web performance can be achieved with good web policies and improvement in website content. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Prabhakaran.
Dr. Prabhakaran, your paper is very thoughtful,
okay,
and data centered.
Yeah.
What we really liked in conferences.
Okay.
I hope that audience over here who are keen on scientometrics and bibliometrics and webometrics will have powerful resources and indicators from your paper for their further research. We will be taking the questions at the end.
Yeah.
So thank you again
for
your nice paper and this introducing us to these WISER indicators.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now I would like to invite Dr. Shiva Chidambaram, who is going to speak on economic viability and essential of discovery services in e-resource environment at medical libraries. Dr. Shiva Chidambaram. Shiva Chidambaram will finish the paper in 5 minutes because
we are
already finished.
Can somebody help me? What to work? Good morning to everybody. Respected Dayas, I'd like to thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank you, the conference organizer, Sri P.T. Jain and Mr. Kar, for providing me opportunity to present my paper for this conference. Yes. Actually, this is. This is mostly applied to our invited speaker, Dr. Tariq. Tariq was mentioning about repositioning the library. When I was taken the assignment of the R&D Institute of Medical Science Library, so we had seen that really the which portion we have to see first the repositioning the library. So our library is majorly concerned about the journals instead of books and the documents. So we had tried to transfer the entire collection of journals to the online format, and how these journals can be reached to the doctors, students, and research scholar through internet or through web environment. This is what our first task. Then we went like this. So this paper has majorly three objectives, actually. This is one is e-resource scenario at our library with the emphasis on need of discovery service, and the essential implementation of EDS at our library, and the economic viability of that discovery. We had given the name single point search with usage statistics analysis. So this is our basically our traditional collection of our library, which has near about 72,430 books. And you see that bound volume journals almost equal to that books and documents. So there is the major concerns we had taken for the first journals. We will go for the online access of the people. So this is our transition stage, that year 2013-14, we have the print journal only 169 and online journals 239. And print plus online, we were having 380. And then 2014, we had entirely transferred these to online, that print journal only we will be having 34, and the online journal has extended because of that budget we saved for the print collections. So avoiding print collection, online we covered more number of journals, and we did a survey also detailed with all the departments that new journals also added to it. And then print plus online journals, we have 32. Then after transferring this, then we thought that how we are going to give to the readers for this journal access. So once we thought of putting A to Z list in the website so that people can go through it. And the second option we thought of going for the all this, whatever the journals we are buying, shall we have the Google-like search for to get all the articles by the users when they search. So that we went to the discovery service. We had done a detailed survey with the other discovery service in the market that EBSCO has forwardly come up, and they had given one year trial, and then we had implemented now. So that they covered only whatever the we subscribed journals, not others, only a subscribed journal, not even open access journals, and plus that whatever the bibliographic library catalog we have, and then plus we have what are the e-books which we are starting now. And this is our composition wise the journals which we have in online now. These are all the publisher wise which we have. That you see that society based journals we have around 381. So in the medical science you can see that every like if you take that pediatrics, they have the association in India and internationally. They are having lot of journals and then databases also. This has to go by each and every website and to search on the particular area. So these are all the things, major area we put it along with this discovery service. And apart from the journals, we also have the other databases like Access Medicine, that is e-books, e-books collections, which also included on the discovery. And Aklan Anatomy is anatomy structure. It is a video clips for the doctors to go for the operation and detecting the bone marrow and all. So this also included on that. Then BMJ case reports, best practice, and up to date. These are all the point of care database. When the doctor goes for the patient and ICU, they used to access through their this thing. They will get immediate information of treatment and what are the disease detection, etc. These also included in that discovery service. And plus Embase is a database like, of course, abstracting and indexing database of mostly covered on drugs and pharmaceutical area, that also included on this collection. Now the implementation of essential web scale discovery services at our library. This is a single point search that screen source that has a search for journal articles and then search for e-books only. And then you can go for search BBDL catalog. These three major categories we have that. And then next screen, which will show that how to do that basic search on that. And then basic single point searches, what are the searches option which we used to do for all the database. There's basic syntax is there with the Boolean search and all these journal wise selections, etc. is available on this screen. And then how to take the results to for your research, that option is there. You can take the relevance wise, whether there are lot of vertical panels have the limiters. Through that limiters, you can have all the databases, results also for your research, further research. Then that details is there with the full text. You can download all the journal articles. And then you can compile a bibliography for your further research, that is by the topic wise, or you can go by the document wise, even books or journals like that. So only for the AIIMS collection, which what we have, that was the basic focus we did it. And then it also search simultaneously with the other databases also, major databases like Access Medicine, other case reports, and then point of care database, which I said. So when you give the one keyword in the single point search there, so it will automatically search for the other databases, and you can directly go to the database and you see the results also. This is the basic advantage of this discovery service. And then you how to cull out your bibliographic details for the further research. This slide shows on that. And then how you can sharing your results, whatever you search, how you can share or you can export to your for research purpose, and it can be given for the RSS feed also for further updation of your research. And these are all the basic export options. And this is a basic economic viability we have. A to Z list we put it, subject wise list we had circulated and given the department wise list, and that also placed in their respective department websites. And remote access, now they are asking for the remote access facilities. We are going to give for the already VPN is going on virtual private network. Through library we are planning to give open Athens for the searching for the only library resources. And these are all the basic recommendations which has come up from the faculty members. So this we are going to implement in future. Easy access to facility through the remote access, device free access. So anybody can access through smartphone or iPad or whatever they have. And encourage the user to use the SPS other than Google and PubMed. People use mostly PubMed. So we can, our staffs are encouraging them that it is almost equal to PubMed. But only the specialty which has is whatever the resource we have within our library. That can be accessed through that. And then conclusion is that whatever is there in the discovery service, it has to be promoted by the librarian. Without librarian, it cannot be possible. Our staffs are keep on given training, and then this is used for the showing the indicator for the return on investment to the people based on the usage statistics. And this is the basic usage statistics we have, that how much abstracts and downloads happens in the, during the last 1 year period after implementation, and then how much search has been done by the faculty members. And this is finally this. If the library metadata does not exist where the users are on the internet, then the library do not exist those users. This is by Stephen K. Browse. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Chidambaram has given very good exposure about the B.B. Dixit Library, which is one of the top libraries in medical sciences. And he gave very detailed information about the type of services, the type of collection and databases they are having. Thank you so much. Thank you. Now, the last speaker of the session is Shri Ram. Shri Ram. He'll be speaking on bibliometric study of the literature on Ebola virus research. There is a particular type of virus on which he's going to speak.
Thank you, ma'am, for giving me the opportunity to present this paper. This is basically a different.
Introduce yourself.
I'm Dr. Sriram. Presently working as a deputy librarian cum assistant professor at Thapar University, Patiala, and I'm also teaching Alam Thapar School of Management as a faculty. So this was conceptualized long back when this was huge spread of Ebola virus globally. So I thought this is a nice opportunity for me to present this paper on this platform. So I conceptualized this paper for the this CoLNet 2015. So, you know, Ebola was one of the most dangerous virus discovered in long back in 1976 in Zaire, where the people who have affected with this virus mostly died because there was no cure available at that time. So it was huge, huge problem in West African region, Zaire, Tanzania, Sierra Leone, and Libya. All those people who have suffered a lot due to this virus. So historically, it is a viral disease from filovirus, where there is no natural host has been discovered during that time, and it was named after the river where in Congo region in Zaire. So after that, they have discovered there are certain virus which is going to be disastrous for the population in West African region. A total of 2,650 Ebola infections have been noticed, and almost more than 50% people have died due to this disease. And highest case of fatality was found to be 88% during Europe in 1976. So these are the areas where these virus have been affected, concerning with the Guinea, Republic of Congo, South Sudan, Gabon, and all western part of the South Africa region was affected with this virus. So if you analyze the geographically where this virus was affected and this disease was spread was the African region, where in 1976, Zaire, and then again in 1995, then 2002. So almost, if you see the casualty rate, it was very high, 88%, 81%, and 79% in those years. Thereafter, in Sudan, 34 cases and almost 65% people were died due to this disease. Then Gabon area, another case in 1994, 1996, and 2002. So the mortality rate was very high because of these things. Then again in recently 2014, Sierra Leone, Guinea region was the most affected place in South African region, where this has made a lot of calamity in that region. So about 8,763 deaths have been reported by WHO during that. That was 35% of total cases. Thereafter, so if you see the chronology from 1976 to 2014, this was the WHO report on 27 July. So most of the people who have suffered from this disease has lost their life. So structurally, it's a single strand variant, which is look like this. So just medical terminology, so I'm not going to let illustrate more on this. But transmission is concerned, the scientists have discovered the most reservoir is the bat, the chamgadar. The bat was the reservoir of the disease, which is carrying this virus to the people. Thereafter, it has been discovered that the chimpanzee, gorillas, or monkeys, they are having the carrier of this virus. Then again, because South Africa region, they have people who are consuming these meats of wild animals, and from those they are again transmitting to human, and from human to human again transmission has been noticed through direct contact. Then contaminated medical equipment, if one equipment is having some viral infection, then it is going to transfer to the other region. Then traditional burial rituals, because a person is died due to Ebola, again they have been buried to due to their rituals, and then been transferred to the human contact. Medical workers also, and also the survivors, if you're having any reproductive these things, so it is going to transfer from one person to other. These are the life cycle where you see from bat, then chimpanzee, then monkey and pigs, people consuming both, all these things. Then again being transferred to these are the small life cycle have been reported by the medical practitioners. So these are the some of the symptoms where the people having suffering with the virus is one of the symptoms, headache, red eye, all these things. But most effective is the diarrhea. Once this effect, it is having continuous medical element of diarrhea, the people losing their fluid from the body and going to suffer. And another is the internal bleeding is another symptom which is causes. So some of the pictures, it's very horrible, but I found that this is not horrible, so horrible, but I put these things. The person is suffering from having all their body ruptured due to the internal bleeding and all these things. So I thought I took this study to showcase the research activity taking place. Till now, research is going on. Vaccination is still in under process. The people are, the medical scientists are working in this area to find out this. But they suggested that isolation is one of the preventive measures. So you might have heard that special wards have been placed everywhere, airport and medical treatment. From there, they are going to isolate the people from general public. So some other biohazardousness is being taken care. So I thought I should took this study to study the dangerous effect of this disease, continuous research, literature growth, and all these things. So as a measure, you know, bibliometrics provide the keen insight to see the strength of research in a particular field. So I took this study to analyze the papers published in the field of Ebola research. I choose a Scopus database for collection of data from by using the keywords Ebola, Ebola virus, and Ebola hemorrhagic fever. These three words I have used in title, abstract, and keyword field. And I took the study from 1977 to 2013. The first paper appeared in 1977 only. There was only one paper. So from there, I analyzed the publication in terms of publication, growth, country distribution, institutional performance, journals, and what are the highly cited papers, then impact factor and citation status of those papers. So those are the basic parameters, bibliometric parameters I used to analyze those reports. So 2,707 papers during those study period 1977 to 2014, I found that there were 2,707 papers distributed in almost eight to nine document types, where journal was the most highest number, comprising of almost 50% of publication, then reviews, then papers, all this. Also some books also written on Ebola. So if you see the publication in terms of breakup, most of the paper published during last 10 years, starting from 2004 to 13. So these are the 60% papers have been contributed in last 10 years. Then if you see the cumulative growth and in terms, it shows that there is exponential growth in terms of with high R value of 9.9529. So this is the status of the publication growth. Till 1999, the growth was not so, but after 99, since in that period, there was a huge outbreak of Ebola research in Western South African country. This is the distribution of the paper in terms of different country. The red spot shows the papers coming from different part of the world. These are the, this is, I analyze in terms of, I put all the data into, there's a software, small software, and through that software, I generate the Google, this, there's a small program for, you can generate the map for a particular distribution. So that I have used this. Then in terms of productivity, USA has highest number of publication, then followed by Germany, then France, then UK, then Canada, then Japan, then Belgium, then Australia, Gabon. Gabon was only one country from African region. No other country have, they have, but they have very less publication in terms of Ebola virus.
Maximum research should have been from there only.
Pardon?
Although maximum should have been from Africa.
Yeah, that's things is coming up, but the publication number was very less in terms of productivity is concerned. Switzerland is another country. So these are the percentage share, how the USA starting from then Switzerland. And in terms of citation, it has been found that the paper published from Switzerland, Australia, and Gabon, and also from Switzerland, they have highest citation as compared to the most productive other countries. So these are the some citation impact is concerned. So though Gabon is having less publication, but their citation impact is more higher than other countries. Then there are certain journals, like most journals belong to virology because this disease is related to virus. So Journal of Virology was the most productive journal with impact factor of 4.6 from 2014. Then again, Journal of Infectious Disease having 152 journals, 5.62%. Then Virology is another journal. Science and Lancet is having good number, but they are in top. Nature was also listed in there. So you can, these five journals have contributed about 18.99% of total productive publication in terms of journals. So these are the list where Nature is also listed. These are having impact factor almost 42. So another interesting thing is, though this disease is more prevalent in South African region, but the institutions are mostly from US and Canada. So US Army Medical Research Center, then Center for Disease Control and Prevention, USA, NIA, USA, then Canada, Germany. So most of the institutions who are working in Ebola ward belongs to the European region or Canada and US region. So I found that only four papers having more citation than as compared to the other papers. So these are having more than starting from 491 to 1170. These four papers, two are published in 2002 and most recently 2008 and 2009. So their citation impact is these papers having more citation growth as compared to the, sometimes it happened the paper which is publishing late, but they have get late citation. Early publication or late citation, these are the concepts have been discovered. But in case the paper which has been published, they are getting more popularity in terms of citation through Scopus only. The citation data was taken from Scopus only. Then in conclusion, I just wanted to conclude that it's a deadly disease which is caused spread due to the bats and also due to the meat-eating people from chimpanzee and monkey. Then total publication of 2,707 during 1977 to 2013.
That you had already given.
Yeah, so these are the three most concluding this thing. Only US, only Gabon was one country which is having publication from those regions where this this disease was prominent. And two, three journals which are having highest impact factor contributed a lot, but there are still more publications coming up as the research is being progressed. In terms of citation, we see that the publication which are less, but they have more citation impact in terms of more productive countries. So these are the some conclusion I have drawn from there. And that's all I want to say. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sriram. He has given a very good exposure of that deadly epidemic, which for which even Indian government was very apprehensive of. That's why foreigners coming to India, we were facing that kind of problem, and he has tried to cover the paper very well. He has given a good exposure of bibliometric analysis of countries according to papers, according to authors, according to year. And thank you so much, Dr. Sriram. Now, just one question for each of the, say, speaker. Dr. Sriram, please.
Thank you, sir.
Database, reliability of Scopus database before 2004, I don't think is very
questionable.
Okay.
Because they claim that they developed the database in 2004 and before that they have covered it, but I don't think it is very authentic.
I'm not right person to comment on that, because maybe Scopus people, if they...
Okay, no problem.
So only thing is, I'm using Scopus database since...
My second point is, did you try to explore why Gaiman has high number of citations?
Yeah, I didn't go into much more deep, but certainly I'll look ahead with another version. Okay.
In my opinion, one of the reason for this may be that Gaiman papers published, I think almost of them must be in international collaboration with USA or some other development.
Okay, thank you, sir. I'll take care this this issue into that.
Question from whom? Question from whom?
Dr. Jain.
Dr. Sriraman.
Yeah, Dr. Jain, sir, please. Yeah, I tried, sir, both the database, but I found because some issue with the citations and some issue with the analysis. So better I choose, because I have
a
good...
He has given a very right suggestion. Very right suggestion. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, but Scopus is claiming that he is covering 100% PubMed. So I thought it's better to have a ready.
Collection of citations from PubMed database is a very difficult task. Yeah. Because there are many databases. So people, they use either Scopus or Web of Science, because they get the citations aggregate.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
That's true.
That's true.
Not the citation data.
Yeah, this is a
web
domain.
Yes, please.
Yes, yes.
Please tell your name.
Yeah, I.
Indian Compare Medical.
Okay, okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, my question.
Yeah, it is a.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
My question is to Dr. Prabhakaran.
Dr. Prabhakaran.
Yes, the previous presenter.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I have a question. Good morning to all. Dr. Prabhakaran, in fact, your presentation is really very good, and it is in the frontier area of research. But I have a question. You have listed all the prominent astrophysics library websites using the WISER methodology. I would like to know, even in India, we have a very good astrophysics library.
Yeah.
You have told the best and the least libraries.
Yeah.
Whether any Indian astrophysics library has taken place in the top 10 list, or what is its actual standards?
Yeah, it is actually, you can say, Indian stuff as astrophysics in Bangalore has the highest rank. Next comes to IUCA. And
what is its rank in the list?
I'll show you in the proceedings.
Okay. Thank you. It was really very useful.
Yeah.
You can read his paper.
Yeah.
Yes, please. You have the question from
for Shiva Sidambaram.
Yeah. Okay, can you repeat it?
Can you give him mic, please?
Yeah.
Can somebody give him mic? और पीछे से आगे आके दे दो.
You see, you have taken WISER, and then there are four components in your study.
Yeah.
And you,
yes.
You just say that
there size, visibility.
Visibility, you have contributed it 50%.
Yeah.
For that particular case, what method you have adapted so that different types of...
Yeah, this is a WISER.
WISER visibility. And then if you have cross-checked it with the Google or Google Scholar or not.
Google Scholar is given, no? 15% weightage is for Google Scholar is given.
There are different types of methods of just analyzing the visibility of a particular website.
Visibility
if
is actually...
cross-checked it or not? Because that is very much important. If you are
visibility is taken for in-links. Visibility is taken from the in-links. In-links, that is called backlinks. Where a website has been referred by others. That has been taken care of.
Thank you so much. Now the last question, because you have to, we have to start another session also. I cannot afford to annoy her. So she's going to ask a question from Dr. Siva Chidambaram.
Siva Chidambaram, just a small question for you. Please, sir. The mic, please. Actually, what you presented about the discovery service,
yes.
That is a great thing, because since in my short stay in UK, I have seen they are using discovery service very much, but in our country it is very rarely used till now. Yeah. So this one point access, do you have this in-house product or you have one outsourced organization for this, for developing this discovery service for this one point access?
As I told you that we had taken the EBSCO discovery service. Okay. So they had given 1 year trial access of collecting our all the resources. Okay. Then after we are started for the subscription for the EBSCO service.
Okay.
EBSCO discovery service.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much.
This question is also Dr. Chivasidambaram. Only one question, ma'am. Actually, the presentation is really very much useful for the working professionals.
Yes.
I would like to know what is the cost factor involved in the subscription, whether it is a perpetual access model service or an annual service.
It's an
annual. It's not a confidential, you can declare, please.
No, it's not a confidential, it's an annual subscription only. It's not a perpetual.
Must have covered in your write up also.
Yes.
Must have covered in your article also.
Yes, yes, it has covered in my article. Yes.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you very much.
I would like to convey my sincere thanks to all the participants who are so patiently sitting and listening and showing the full intention and attraction towards the what our readers, speakers were speaking. And we are also thankful to all the distinguished guests. And I am thankful to my co-chair, Dr. Sushmita, and my keynote speaker, Dr. Tariq Ashraf, and the organizers, Dr. Jain, Dr. Kar, and everybody. I should not miss anybody to convey my sincere thanks. And thanks for inviting me for chairing this session. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Please wait a moment. I really thank to all paper presenters for sharing their views with us. And I would like to say special thanks to our invited speaker and our chair of this session and co-chair of this session. Now I request Mr. S.K. Dogra, please present a memento to our chair, Dr. Shashi Prabha Singh.
Thank you very much.
I request Dr. Sangam to please present a memento to Dr. Tariq Ashraf. I request Dr. Satish Monali to kindly present a memento to Dr. Sushmita Chakravarti. Now I request Dr. Shashi Prabha Singh to kindly give a token of thanks to our paper presenters. Dr. R. Prabhakaran, kindly come.
This is the best responsibility which I have been given. Yes. Thank you.
Dr. Iram Mukhtar Mahajan.
None of them is here, I think so.
Dr. Shiva Chitambaram. Dr. Shriram.
Where is that young boy? Where is Shriram?
Ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Please come within 15 minutes after the tea. That session will be start. No, we are already late. Please go for the tea.